Thank you. phrase, it's not a kind of power that you can assume. But it's an evocative phrase. It suggests that it's generative. It calls to mind a couple of images to me. First one would be a softball player who chatters all day long. Hey, man, hey, man, hey, man. And somebody's pitch, another one's playing a strike one, two more to go. Right? But the thing always seems to be in the game, immersed in the game, and in the vocabulary, the words are reflective of the fact that she is. Another image comes to mind, very different spectrum of a tiki flavor to it, but I'm not really in the day and age. If somebody likes a movie, they're going to if you like an article, you're going to tweet that. If you want to give somebody a cyber pat on the back, you tweet that so people can think, example of art. And rather than charges to be with judge, be baptized, to confess their sins, or else a person will submit to those judges. There's one coming after you who's far ahead of me. I'm not even ready to just stoop down and apply your sins. Finally, John points to the most pointless or important signifier of who Jesus is, because John says, see, this Jesus, from heaven, from the world, is the beautiful news that is known. See, this is one who has been authorized and authenticated by him. He's been authorized and authenticated by him. Okay, so we say that Jesus is coming back under the waters. Says that he is open. And what we want to keep in mind here, probably, is not just some visual, but some visual. Isaiah said of all, God, that you would rend the heavens, that you would tear the mountains, and come down so that the mountains would tremble. Oh, that you would rend the heavens, and come down, and Jesus and something says that. Here's a voice. And the voice says, you are my son. And as we listen carefully again, we hear the allusions, we hear two very important texts coming to our attention and to our attention. And the first one comes from Psalm 2. This is what the psalmist says, why do the nations the people's plot in vain. The kings of the earth, they take their stand, and the rulers gather together against the war and against the wage of war. And they say, let us break their chains and throw off their feathers, and the Lord scoffs them. He rebukes them in his anger, and he terrifies them in his wrath. And he says, see, I've never stopped my pain. Proclaimed the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son. You are my son. And I'm going to ask of me. And I'll give the nations of the earth to bring this thing to pass. This is the first text that Mark draws our attention. It's the voice of the heavens. You're the king. So Jesus, you're my son, meaning you are the king. And the second text that Mark calls to our attention is Isaiah 42. Here we read these words before the earth is destroyed. My chosen one, whom I delight, I'll put my spirit on him, and he'll bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or call out or raise his voice in the streets of the earth to me. He will be great in his glory and will be great in faithfulness. He will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged, just as ready to do whatever it is Jesus said. Make us a form of assurance to him. So what if our challenge is to start? What if we didn't have to come up with our own terms? What if we didn't have to come up with our own challenges? What if we didn't have to come up with our own explanations? What if we just throw the marks? Just listen to what we're saying about who Jesus is and his significance for us. That was the Father's word. What if that was the way in which we testify to who Jesus is? We use that testimony as ways of inviting others to make Jesus the gravitational center. Thank you. Thank you.